That you indeed will indeed feel welcome as you have come to worship with us as well. Just a few brief announcements to remind you of. If you haven't already checked the Facebook page, or if you haven't received it via email, just a few reminders. This afternoon at 3 p.m., Hillcrest Estate Chapel service hosted by the Joy Group, but is not limited to Joy Group. And so if you would like to come along to be a part of that, we encourage you to indeed come to Hillcrest this afternoon at 3 p.m. Then at 6:30, prayer and worship time at the Park Avenue Pentecostal Church. This is the follow-up from the service that they had in June. And they're having another one this evening at 6:30. And we encourage you to come to be a part of that as we meet together to pray and worship, to pray about our city, to pray about the needs of our city and the surrounding areas that we are a part of. And so we encourage you to come to be a part of that. Next Sunday, October the 1st, will be the annual Truth and Reconciliation Sunday. You're encouraged to wear your orange t-shirt, your orange shirt on that Sunday in recognition of the Truth and Reconciliation. Special guests will be Margaret Cranford, who is a visual artist and a community justice activist. And so we look forward to what's going to be happening next Sunday morning here at Mount Pearl Citadel. In advance, on October the 5th, which is a Thursday evening, we will be recommencing our Bible study for the year. And so we encourage you to come to be a part of a Bible study. Studying the scriptures is important to a follower of Jesus. It's important to the strength and the establishment of our church. And so we encourage you to come to be a part of that on Thursday, October the 5th at 7 p.m. October the 9th at 12:30 p.m., our church will be serving a Thanksgiving dinner, a dinner for any senior who would like company for Thanksgiving. And I believe it's eat-in only, right? Eat-in only. So if you're like me, a senior, and you don't want to be alone on Thanksgiving, you're invited to come to partake in this Thanksgiving dinner. But you have to let Major Morgan know by September the 30th if you're going to come. Because if not, there might not be enough turkey for you. And we don't want that to happen. So be governed accordingly. We also this morning recognize a donation that has been made to the Corps in memory of Ross Duffett by the Duffett family. And we do thank them for that donation. And we pray that as they recall memories of their loved one, that the Lord will indeed bless and grant peace and blessing to them. We come this morning as individuals. But also, we are a family. And because we are a family, we can come together just as we are. We are here to worship. And if we need to mend fences or rebuild bridges, we can come just as we are to the one who created us and can redeem us by his blood, and who can restore us to a wholeness in him. We come to worship. We come into his presence.
And we are invited into his presence this morning, where we will find healing, strength, wisdom, whatever we need. So our first chorus this morning is, come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise. And we certainly have so much to praise him for. We're here, we have the freedom to worship, and we have such a beautiful day in which to worship. Please stand with us. give that glory and honor and power unto him, we follow Romans 12:1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And as we sing the second chorus, Here I Am to Worship, that is what we need to do this morning. In our hearts, just say, Lord, all of me, I am here to worship. Open my eyes. Let me see what you need me to see. Speak to me, Father, and use me. When we consider the last part of this chorus where it talks about, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. It is truly the only thing that we can do, since he's done so much for us, is just to surrender it all. Light of the world. Within our hearts this morning, thank him for all he does, for each and every day that he gives us, and for all the blessings that he showers on us. Into thy presence, we come.
Thank you. Now we're going to sing In the Presence of Jehovah. When we come to God's presence, so many things change, doesn't it? Our attitude changes. Our lives change. Perspective changes. We get a sense of peace, a sense of hope. Light flickers in the darkness of our lives. Troubles vanish. Hearts are mended when we come in the presence of the King. Remember Denzel this morning, Kathy and the Baggs family, and the passing of Denzel's brother yesterday. Pray that God will surround that family today. We continue to uplift Sydney. We mentioned Sydney last Sunday, Major Darrell Kimberry's daughter. Had an accident a couple weeks ago, still critical. Still battling those battles. Remember Vernon, Chantel's dad, who had surgery this past week. Came in from St. Anthony for surgery. Remember those in hospital? Those who are awaiting surgeries today? Those who are just in a rough spot this morning. Darkness seemed to cloud that vision. We pray for hope and we pray for peace. Let's sing this through. Pray three times this morning. As we just worship Him this morning. So still that we can hear each whispered word. When we pause to pray, we enter your cathedral this morning. And those are the times when you become so real and so near to us. This morning we humbly bow, seeking your grace, your love, seeking your strength today. As we come interceding on the behalf of others today, And Father, you know every name that we've read out. You know names that haven't been read out. You know the concerns on our hearts for those who are just grieving today, those awaiting surgeries today, those recovering today, those awaiting test results today, those who are in dark places today. We pray that your light will shine brightly in that darkness. That they will sense your presence in a very real, amazing, and transforming way today. We thank you for this place where we gather, this place where we come to meet with you, but a place we come to be encouraged, to be uplifted, to be strengthened, to find light and to find hope in you today. Lord, we thank you for the week that's been gone. We thank you because as we look back on this week, we can see those footsteps, those markers on our path where you have been there, where you have carried us, where you have been our mainstay. And for that, we are grateful today. Thank you for an opportunity of coming and worshiping today to uplift your name and to feel your presence in our lives, to feel your peace. And as we continue to worship this morning, we pray that your presence will surround us, whether we're here in this building or if we're watching live stream, wherever we may find ourselves today, that your presence will just engulf us, bringing peace and hope to our lives. Bless us. Bless the remainder of this service, all that will take place this morning. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Thank you, band, for that beautiful selection this morning. That was played at my request because it ties in with the theme of my sermon this morning, which is intercessory prayer, praying for others. And I know there's many of us are here today because somebody prayed for us. Amen? And God asks us that we do the same unto others. Scripture reading this morning is taken from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. I urge them, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. May God bless the reading of his word this morning.
As instructed by the Apostle Paul in the scriptures, we are going to give our tithes and offerings unto the Lord, because in 1 Corinthians 16, verses 1 and 2, he said, "Now about the collection for God's people. On the first day of the week, give as you have been given." So that's what we're going to do, and I invite the ushers to stand for prayer. Father, thank you for your faithfulness today, your faithfulness in supplying all of our needs, providing all of our provisions, providing strength in our weakness. You are more than enough. And so today, help us to give in response. Help us to give out of love. Help us to give because you have blessed us accordingly. Amen. Okay. Oh, hi guys. Can you see me? Can you hear me? Come on over here. So, because we've got a little something to look at today. I brought along with me some sandwiches. Something a little bit silly for children's time, hey. But today, we're going to use my sandwiches to learn a little bit about prayer. And we're going to make some prayer sandwiches today, okay? So, can one of you tell me, what's prayer? Yeah, I know, it's your baby sister. She's two. Oh, my goodness, Ophelia, she's precious. Ophelia, can you help me and tell me a little bit about what's prayer? What do I mean when I say we pray? Just into the microphone.
pray to Jesus. To worship.
To worship him. We pray to Jesus to worship him. She's 100% right. You know what? With prayer, we can tell Jesus or God everything and anything, right? So look at my sandwiches here today. So, oh, we'll help her. Yes, you know what? That's okay. We're going to just really look today, but out in Sunday school, they'll help her make stuff for sure. So guys, what's the same about every, so these are, there's three sandwiches here, and they're all cut up in half. What's the same about every single sandwich, usually? What's the same? Go ahead. You help us out. Made between bread, right? So there's a slice of bread on the top, slice of bread on the bottom, right? I'll just show you right quick. I'll pull out one. And look, so this one, all of them, they all have a slice of bread on the top. You see it? And a slice of bread on the bottom. So we're going to talk a little bit about prayer today, kind of being like that. Yep. Oh, so a cheese and ham. You know what? I got a cheese and ham sandwich right in here. Yeah, we're going to talk about that in a second. So there's bread on the top and bread on the bottom, right? So a prayer is just like that, because usually with prayers, we start off on the top of a prayer saying something. And it's often, dear God, or Heavenly Father, or dear Lord, right? Something that just says, God, I'm really going to talk to you right now. Okay, so that's at the top of the sandwich. And then on the bottom of the sandwich, what do we always say at the end of every prayer? Can you remember? Amen. Exactly. So that's kind of the end of the prayer, the bottom of the prayer, that kind of says, thank you so much, God, for listening to me. Right? So there's the top and the bottom. That's the same in most every prayer. But what's really cool about prayers, is that it can be a tiny prayer. Like, I'm going to show you this sandwich. So this one here, these two, they're the same. Anybody know what kind of sandwich that might be? I got them all wrapped. Nutella, exactly. That's like one of my favorite ones. Yeah, Nutella. But there's only one thing on this sandwich, right? Nutella. But look at this guy. This guy here is a little different. What's in this one, do you think? Not yet. This one is peanut butter and jelly. That's another classic, isn't it? Peanut butter. But there's two things inside that sandwich. You know what? I got one that got, and this is the one you're going to like. It's got, like, mayonnaise and ham and what else? Cheese and tomato. So it's got, like, a lot inside that sandwich. And you know what? Prayers are kind of like that. You can have the top and the bottom, and then you can put in as much stuff in that prayer sandwich as you want. You can tell God, maybe you just got one little thing that you want to talk to God about, just like the Nutella sandwich, and you want to say, oh, can you please help me in school today? I'm feeling a little bit nervous, right? Or you could have like a super duper sandwich that got like five things, and you need to talk to God a lot and tell him everything that happened in your day, right? So I want you to think about today how prayer is just like a sandwich, okay? And we talked about prayer this morning already, and I think we're going to talk about it a little bit more. And guess what's happening today? Sunday school is starting back up today. Woohoo! So I know the Sunday school teachers are super excited to get you guys out there. So we're going to end in a prayer today. And I got one little thing for you for homework tonight. Can I tell you homework? And then you tell me your thing. You do. Oh, homework. Yep, lots of homework because school started. Well, I'm going to give you homework for tonight. Oh, my goodness. Well, you know what? I bet you if you do your prayer homework tonight, you guys might be able to get a sticker from your mom or dad or your nan or your pop or someone. So tonight what I want you to do is I want you to go home tonight before bed. I want you to make a super huge prayer sandwich and talk to God, and God is ready to listen anytime about anything that you want to talk to him about. Okay, so we're going to stand up, hands together, and we're going to say prayer. Yep. Yeah? Exactly. And when you look in your lunch bag at school, you're going to remember how important it is to have a prayer, right? Just like a prayer sandwich. Okay, let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and we're going to say a little prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for always listening to us as we pray, whether we have a lot to say or just a little that we bring to you in prayer. May you continue to be with us, guiding and protecting us every day. And what's the end of the prayer? Amen. Okay, you guys are off to Sunday school, and the teachers will help figure out which class you're in this year.
I think we can all take a lesson from Renee's object lesson this morning. Thank you so much, Renee. In the Salvation Army, today is the annual day of prayer for victims of human trafficking, always the last Sunday of September. The Salvation Army is deeply committed to fighting and responding to modern slavery and human trafficking. We have a theological and historical mandate. We believe prayer is foundational and an essential, powerful tool to fight for freedom and work towards a world free from exploitation. Today, we have been invited to join the Salvation Army, partners, and friends worldwide to corporately cry out for justice and freedom. This year's theme is "I Have Heard Their Cries." It comes from Exodus 2:23-25. The Israelites groaned under the slavery and cried out. Out of the slavery, their cry for help rose up to God. God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This morning, we are blessed to have Megan with us, and Megan has an experience that she wants to share of how she saw human trafficking and modern slavery firsthand. So Megan, please come share your testimony.
Hello. So as you heard, today is the annual Day of Prayer for Human Trafficking. And yeah, it is one that I hold close to my heart. So a couple months after I graduated high school, I moved to Hanover, Germany, and I found myself helping out with the Salvation Army Corps there. I helped with anything and everything at the church, from Bible studies to flea markets and the community meals. But the most impactful part of the job, however, was our Wednesday evening ministry, which was in the red light district, which we could see from the windows of the church. It was my officer, a young social worker, and myself on the team, all women, all very young, and the evening would go like this. We would always start by making cupcakes, believe it or not. We'd prepare cupcakes and tea and coffee in travel containers, and we'd put it in a backpack. Then our next step was praying, and we'd read through Ephesians 6:10-17, and we would act out putting on the armor of God. It was a little silly ritual that we did every time. And then we'd head out on our route. So we'd pass all sorts of buildings that held darkness behind their doors and the broken people who frequented those buildings. At the end of each road, we'd pray. One person would be praying, and the other two would be looking in either direction to keep watch and make sure that we were safe. After about 20 minutes of walking through the city center, the drug hotspot of Hanover, we'd get to our target location, a street with hotels, brothels, with large windows where one or two women sat in each like merchandise of a store. We'd show them the cupcakes as an offer to talk, and they could either wave us away politely, or they would open the window and take a cupcake and chat with us for a bit. We'd ask them how long they had worked that day, and that was as far as we'd ever talk about their work. We talked about their families. Often they were mothers who were desperately sending money back to their kids in their home countries because they had no other choice. We talked about hobbies they had before they were forced into the position they found themselves in. I remember one young woman who loved telling us about how she used to ride horses and how she dreams of a day that she'll be able to do that again. I think of her often. We had young girls who looked younger than me at the time, who would tell us about how they had worked in Berlin and Madrid and five other cities before they ended up in Hanover. One woman told us every Wednesday for a couple months that she was soon going back to her home country to spend a week with her kids, and it was all she could think about. She was so excited to see them, and she shared with us all about her young children. The woman I think the most often would have been around 60 years old. She talked to us on the first day that we went out and shared a lot of her heart with us. I'll call her V in this. So my officer was Italian, and V would speak Italian with her because she had worked in Italy for a while, and the social worker was German, so V would speak German with her, and she spoke her native English with me. As time went on, the women would eventually ask us to pray with them, and because V was the only one who spoke fluent English, and I only felt comfortable praying in English, my officer usually ended up encouraging me to pray with her, and I did many times. For her health, for her family, who were back in her home country, and for her freedom. One day, my officer had received a bunch of flowers that she didn't know what to do with, but Valentine's Day was luckily coming up, so I had the idea that we could give them to the women in the windows. So we wrote Bible verses on little notes and attached them to all of the flowers, but on V's, we wrote a special message about how loved she was. She gave us each a very big, tearful hug, and every Wednesday that we went out after that, she had that flower and its note displayed in the window. So on this annual day of prayer for human trafficking, I would like to ask you to keep these women in mind. Women who have hobbies like all of us, who like to ride horses, who have families and kids and people who love them. Women who carry so much sadness in their eyes, hopelessness, darkness. Women who would laugh with us over a silly cupcake that we put colorful sprinkles on, just to be one source of light for them for that day. Women who would give us a big tearful hug over a little pink flower and a reminder that she is loved. Women who are desperate for change but feel that change is impossible. Women who jumped at the chance to hear us pray over them. And I say women, but it extends further. I would like to ask you to keep in mind the children who are forced into a world behind the scenes that no one should find themselves in. For the men who are forced to work harder than their bodies allow them. For anyone who finds themselves in that position. And my stories are from Germany, but this isn't a distant issue for other countries of the world. Pray for those in our communities who are suffering in secret as well.
Thank you so much, Megan. Before we have a prayer in unison together, we're going to sing song 1002 in the psalm book. And this song came to mind as I was preparing the service this morning, when the theme was, I have heard their cries. And it says, I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in darkened sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? God sent you, Megan, to make a difference. And he wants us to make a difference as well. Here I am, Lord. It is I, Lord. I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you.
please remain standing, and I will ask the band to stand. As a congregation this morning, we will publicly declare our collective commitment to listen and pray for the millions of people who are currently experiencing modern slavery and human trafficking. Just as God remembers, hears, and is close to those who are afflicted by human slavery and trafficking, so do we. Let's pray together. Dear God, we pray for victims of human trafficking, for those who have been dehumanized and held captive by the greed and violence of a broken world, for girls and boys, women and men who are bought and sold and abused by those who have forgotten the eternal value of a human soul. May they rediscover their worth in you. And may we affirm their worth as individuals who are made in your image. Lord, reveal the way our choices may play a part in keeping others captive by creating demand for more slaves, and give us courage to make different choices. Give us eyes to see injustice and exploitation, and give us the courage to speak out against evil. Use us to bring light into the darkened corners of this world, that they may not remain dark forever. May your light expose the evil deeds of the captors, and may your love create a change of heart within those who are perpetrators of human trafficking. Use us to loosen the chains of injustice and let the oppressed go free. We pray for an end to the evil that is human trafficking, and we pray that the victims of trafficking may find restoration and healing in you. Amen. You may be seated. And now Anna's going to come and bless us with a solo.
Storms have come and darkened my sun. After all that I've been through, who on earth can I turn to? I look to you. Gone, and you I can be strong. I look to you. And when melodies are gone and you are here a song, I look to you.
Let's pray before Lisa comes with the word. Father, we thank you. Thank you for your presence. We thank you, you are always there, and we can look to you. In our weakness, in our doubts, your strength is made perfect. And as Lisa comes right now, Father, with your word, we pray that her strength will be your strength. And the words you have given her this week may indeed be encouragement for us. May it point us to you. Bless her, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
In his book, Stories for the Journey, William White tells the story of a European seminary professor and his wife, Hans and Enid. During World War II, they escaped to America, where Hans began teaching in a seminary. Students loved this Bible teacher, and they enjoyed observing the tender love that Hans and Enid displayed as the couple often walked hand in hand around the campus. Enid's unexpected death sends Hans into a pit of sorrow. The seminary president and three other friends began visiting him, but he remained lonely and depressed. "I am no longer able to pray to God," Hans confided in them. "In fact, I'm not certain I believe in God anymore." After an awkward moment of silence, the seminary president responded, "Then we will believe for you. We will pray for you." In the following weeks, the four men met daily to pray with Hans, asking God to help Hans experience God's presence and healing. Months later, as the four men gathered again in Hans' living room, Hans greeted them with a smile. "It is no longer necessary for you to pray for me," he said. "Instead, I would like for you to pray with me." These men were praying for their friend, intercessing to God on his behalf. When he couldn't pray for himself, they filled in the gap. Intercessory prayer. Big word, but a simple meaning. It's simply praying for others. With today being International Day of Prayer for Human Trafficking, I reflected this week on the concept of intercessory prayer. We've all been there, on both sides of the fence. Either we've asked others to pray for us, or we've been asked to pray for someone else. Simple concept, really. I'll pray for you, you pray for me. I thought maybe this is too simple for a sermon. But then God said, no. The Holy Spirit is leading me this morning to explore the concept with you. Who do we pray for? Why do we pray? And when do we pray for others? Intercession is defined as request on behalf of others, bringing the needs of others and placing them before God's throne, a prayer to God on behalf of someone else. The term intercession is not scriptural. God is our intercessory, but you'll never see the word intercession in the Bible. But the concept itself is stamped all over God's word. First of all, why do we pray for others? We pray for others for a number of reasons. In 1 Timothy 2:1, God, through Paul, commands us to pray for others. Paul urges, "I urge them, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone." Paul is telling the believers that intercession should be made for everybody. Paul mentions a number of different prayers, but the focus is not the different types, as the beautiful scope of prayer. We can come before God with requests, needs, and desires, not only for ourselves, but for others as well. Paul is urging Timothy to pray for all, not just those he would choose to pray for. We pray for others because Jesus did so, and he set the example for us. Luke 22:32 says, "I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail." Jesus prays for Simon Peter, the disciple that failed by denying him. Jesus interceded to the Father on his behalf. And as Christians, our aim in life is to be like Jesus. Jesus prayed for others. So should we. According to Samuel, not to pray for others is a sin, especially for leaders of the church. In 1 Samuel 12 and 23, it says, "As for me," Samuel says, "far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by failing to pray for you." Samuel tells the people that he would be sinning against God if he failed to pray for the people under him. Samuel considers it a sin for leaders of God's people not to pray for those they lead. Finally, we pray for others because prayer has great power. James 5 and 16 tells us to pray for each other because the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We pray because prayer has power. Prayer is our most powerful resource, the opportunity and ability to communicate with God. It should never be our last resort, but our first go-to. God is pleased to use our prayers to accomplish his purpose, and he delights in answering our prayers. Recap. Why do we pray for others? Because it is commanded. Jesus sets the example. It is a sin not to. And prayer has great power. We all know we should pray for others. But does this encourage us to pray for more this morning? Pray with intention, to pray like Jesus. May we truly be empowered and encouraged to pray more for others. Secondly, who do we pray for? Scripture is quite clear, but I do not have an exhaustive list this morning, and I will focus on four. Obviously, we are called to pray for the sick. James 5:16b says, "Pray for each other so that you may be healed. Pray for those who are ill, suffering, have difficult diagnoses." But as Warren Wiersbe states, a theologian, and I agree, sometimes we don't know how to pray for the sick. Anyone agree with me this morning? Paul shares a similar thought in Romans 8:26, "Not knowing what to pray, but trusting the Holy Spirit to know the need." Sometimes when I pray with people in hospitals, and my nursing background kicks in too, and I think, okay, God, you could heal them, but I know it's within your will that you could choose not to heal them. And that puts me in a limbo sometimes. How do you pray for the sick? We all know God can perform miracles. We never doubt that. But we also have to be cognizant of the fact that sometimes it's God's will that they not be healed here on earth, but in eternity. We pray according to his will. We cannot claim that God will heal every case and that it is not his will for children to be sick, all denying both scripture and experience. But when we have an inner conviction for the word and the spirit that it is God's will to heal, then we can pray the prayer in faith and expect God to work. But pray according to his will. We are also called to pray for the saints. In Ephesians 6 and 18, Paul says, "And pray in the spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints." Why pray for the saints? Because we pray to be on guard against Satan. He strikes in different ways at different people. We need to pray for one another. No one is exempt from Satan's target. Therefore, all the saints need our prayer support. No matter who they are, what position they hold, or how strong they may seem to be, no believer can stand alone in this battle. Reflect on this for a moment. We pray the Lord's Prayer together, but we don't say, "My Father." We say, "Our Father." We pray as a great family that is talking to God, and we pray for other members of that family. Even Paul asked the saints to pray for him. Everybody needs the prayers of others. Yet there are others we need to pray for as well. Paul tells Timothy in 1 Timothy 2 and 2, we are to pray for those in authority. We are to pray for our government leaders. In context, Paul is asking is considered remarkable. The current emperor of Rome was Nero, a notorious cruel leader who was persecuting believers. Yet in spite of this, believers were being taught to control government, were being taught to support government, not to rebel against it. God is ultimately in control. He sets up and removes all leaders. By praying for leaders, we can help restore the quiet and peace to our lives. Even when we may not respect the women and men in authority, we must respect their offices and pray for them. I'm going to repeat that because that spoke to my heart this week. Even when we may not respect the women and men in authority, we must respect their offices and pray for them. Though persecuted, they are wise by praying for government leaders. Quiet means the circumstances around us, and peaceable indicates a small attitude, a calm attitude within. Finally, we are to pray for our enemies. Jesus clearly states in Matthew 5 and 44, we are to pray for our enemies and we are to love them as well. The Old Testament never tells us to hate our enemies, but the Pharisees, whom Jesus is speaking to, may have had their own interpretation of some Old Testament passages about hatred for God's enemies. Jesus is saying we are to love them, we are to pray for them, and this is a true sign that Jesus is Lord of our lives. Jesus is setting a higher standard than the world's expectations for his disciples, a standard that is impossible on mere human strength alone. People who have experienced God's love understand what it means to be loved unconditionally. And only with the help of God's Spirit can his people love and pray for those who seek to do him harm. Scripture gives us clear indication on who we are to pray for: saints, each other, the sick, those in authority, government leadership, and our enemies. This morning, does this list resemble our prayer list? Or do we need to make some adjustments? Who is God placing on your heart this morning to take before him in prayer? Who needs to be added to your prayer list? Finally, when do we pray? Paul tells us, pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17 says, pray continuously. Does this mean that we go around all day in a posture of prayer? No, that would be a bit unrealistic. Continuous prayer involves an attitude of openness to God in all situations and a practice of talking to God about all situations. We can't bow our heads and close our eyes and fold our hands without ceasing. These are customs of prayer, not prayer itself. Prayer is communication with God, and we can live each minute of the day in a constant flowing conversation with God. Does anyone pray while they're driving? Don't close your eyes. Prayer is communication with God, and we can live each moment of the day in a constant flowing conversation with him. There's great value in every moment of the day in fellowship with God. Wherever we are, we can pray. Pray without ceasing. Pray continuously. Voice is not important. Proper posture is not necessary. Time is not significant. Place is not significant. We can pray anywhere. When do we pray? How often do we pray? Is it possible to add more prayer time to your day? More time to pray for others. How is God speaking to your heart this morning? Is he challenging your prayer life? Are you adequately praying for others? Who's on your prayer list today? And is there anyone you need to add? Never underestimate the power of your prayer. Your prayer can make a huge difference in someone's life. Recently, God laid it on my heart to pray for a family member. She had not been on my radar in the past as someone that I would pray for, but I knew that she was going through a rough time, so I prayed for her. I texted her that day to let her know that I whispered her name in prayer. And this was her response. It is so nice to know that we are in someone's prayers. I think that's the nicest thing I have heard someone say to me in a very long time. Thank you very much. Who is God asking you to pray for this morning? Who is he laying on your heart? Who needs your prayers today? It may be for healing. They may be experiencing financial difficulties. They may have relationship issues. They may need salvation. They may need a relationship with God. God can be prompting you to pray for your enemy, someone with whom you're in conflict. Our Prime Minister and our Premier need our prayers today. Our leaders of the Salvation Army need our prayers today. Maybe God is leading you to pray for a member of our congregation, a fellow saint. As the Holy Spirit leads this morning, may you be obedient. May you pray. Shall we pray together? Father, a simple concept, praying for others, but God, a powerful message this morning. God, I've been challenged in my own message. You've spoken to my heart. And I pray, God, that you've spoken to those here, listening within the congregation and online. God, we can never pray too much. We can never pray for too many people. You never get tired of hearing us. But I believe, Lord, it brings joy to your heart to hear us whispering the names of others, to be a family, a Christian fellowship that brings the needs before you, and you hear every prayer. God, our prayer may make the difference in someone else's life. May we be obedient to your Holy Spirit this morning. I pray that we will come, kneel before you, and pray for those that you are laying on our hearts this morning. And may those people feel the strength of our prayers. Be amongst us in these next few moments, we pray. In thy name, amen. I invite you to come this morning and to pray, because there's power in prayer, power to spare. All that you'll ever need is waiting right there. Just a few words, a child's faith, and it's goodbye despair. For there's power, so much power, there's power in prayer. And I will remind you again that the focus will be on the screen, not the altar. This is private moments between us and God. There's power in prayer, power to spare. Bless them now. Heavenly Father, bless them now. Who's on your heart this morning? Who needs your prayer today? Bring them before God. He'll hear the prayer. And as Renee reminded us, it doesn't have to be long and eloquent and beautiful words. God hears the sentences. God hears the one and two words. God hears it all. And even when we can't put it into words, God knows our heart. Bless them now. Heavenly Father, bless them now. back to my husband, "For you, I am praying. For you, I am praying." There's somebody praying for you today. I truly believe that. "For you, I am praying. I am praying for you." We all can tell stories, I'm sure, of praying mothers and praying grandmothers. And we can all say that I wouldn't be here today without the prayer of somebody. Who needs your prayers today? "For you, I am praying." Let's stand for a change of position.
Song this morning, 855 in your songbook. "I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, how he left his home in glory for the cross on Calvary." The fourth verse says, "Days of darkness still come o'er me, sorrow's path I have often tread, but the Savior still is with me. By his hand I'm safely led." Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, sing it with the saints in glory gathered by the crystal sea. With the help of the band, straight through, please.
Thank you.
announcements for the coming week, especially if you're a senior and alone for Thanksgiving Monday for your turkey dinner, please let me know. Lisa, my wife, will be out of town this week, Monday to Friday. She will be totally disconnecting from anything that can get a hold of her, even me. Totally disconnecting. She's on her way to Ontario with a number of people for a holiness retreat. She flies out tomorrow morning and flies back late Thursday night, so please keep her in prayer. If there's anything pertinent, anything that you need to get a hold of her for, don't. Give me a call, or you can wait until Friday. So please, I ask you of that, because she will not have access to anything. No emails, and only if it's an emergency text from me will she answer. So please, if you have any concerns that you need to get a hold of her, contact me or wait till she comes back. Benediction this morning, Lord of all glory and of all grace, Lord of all nations, worlds, and space, Lord God, o'er all eternity, reign thou. O reign thou over me. Father, we thank you for these moments this morning, these moments of reflection, these moments of worship and praise, these moments of hearing you, from your word, moments of encouragement. And as we leave this morning and go and be the church, may we be that beacon in a dark world. Bless us, protect us, we ask in Jesus' name, giving thanks. Amen and amen.